Christy. Welcome to another Better Way Ministry Bible study. Today's study, will you be judged or learn his judgments? Pretty simple question. You're going to learn his judgments or you will be judged. Let's pray. Father, we just love you. You're a great God. You have all power and authority. You're not worried in the heavens today about the things we see on this earth. Father, you just are God. I pray this word would open the eyes of every living soul that hears your word, that it would live in their heart and set them free to enjoy the rest of God, of the Christ of God, living in the kingdom of God. Father, your word is pure and it is a wonderful thing. And we love you and we thank you for giving thy word unto us. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you be judged? Or learn his judgments. Just learn his judgments. Who wants to be judged? We've already been judged. We'll get to that. Every word of God is pure. You know, if this ministry could do anything at all, I would tell the whole world, every word of God is pure. You can trust him. When he said, for this is the love of God, that you keep his commandments. His commandments are not grievous. Be a doer of his word. When he says love somebody, oh, you can't leave them. No, no, no. You can leave them, but you can't leave them. And you can't set yourself free, but I can set you free. You know, the church today is like it was when Christ came. When the Lord came as a child, the church was ready for the coming of the Lord. They were all looking for him. They were, why do you think it was such big news? Andrew, hey, I found the Christ. Peter, hey, psst. There was an empty chair in every synagogue. That empty chair was for the Christ. When he came, they were going to let him sit in that chair. And they were going to accept their Christ. The government's on his shoulders. He's going to put Israel over this Roman occupation, and he's coming. But they didn't understand his judgments. And they ended up being judged and missing the Messiah, the Christ. As it was then, so it is this day. Churches now, instead of the fear of the Lord, they all hold hands and talk about communal blessings. Wow. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. Will you be judged or learn his judgments? The children of God in today's body of Christ are commanded to watch. That's what you're commanded to do. There's no command to prepare for your house. As to the things for life, food, shelter, clothing, but your heart is to be prepared. I'm not saying don't work, but work is not what feeds and clothes you. Work is the fulfillment of one of the commands. We need to take no thought for our lives. Yes, we go to work. But we live from our giving. The way we're going to see Jesus coming is by keeping his commandments that we watch. There is no command, none, that we should be, what do they call those people that are getting prepared for the Great Tribulation? Do you want to try and prepare yourself so that you keep yourself safe, or would you rather rely on God? For safety is of the Lord. Take a look at when the Christ was born. He was born at a Roman occupation, powerful army. The most powerful. When Herod figured it out that there was a king that was born, he sent to the town that he was born in and killed every child. It was a powerful army that could impose their judgments over any living soul. They did not have sword and spear. In fact, whenever the Lord at the Last Supper, they found a couple spears, but two out of how many? It wasn't that they had guns and knives that made them safe. They had a God. When Joseph was commanded to leave the inheritance and go to Egypt, he didn't take off in an M1A1 Bradley or an Abrams tank. He didn't. He took off on a donkey with a pregnant wife that he had to go slow with. He was a target. But no one could find him. Why? Because safety is of the Lord. We're commanded to watch. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt. And where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Judgment. God's judgments. We want to learn his judgments. He's trying to tell you here that if you're in the world and all this is all the only thing that you can think about, your heart is there. It's not with him. I don't care if you all get together and hold hands. It's not going to make you heard. When you humble your heart before your Lord, there's nothing he will withhold from you. He said, fear lest any of you should seem to come short of the promise of God of entering into his rest. Why? Because he wants you resting in his great love wherewith he has provided all things for you. The light of the body is in the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. If you're singly focused on the Christ, that if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. Remember the saying in Scripture, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters. He's setting this thing up. Look, I put you in the world, but the devil's in charge of it. He's got a system down there that if you join, you're going to miss it. You can't serve his system and me. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You just can't do it. You're going to work and you're going to go to work, but you're living from your giving. You're not living from your wages. Therefore, I say, a lot of the church world is, and that's how come there's lack. Yeah, I remember those days of lack. because I didn't understand the judgments. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you're going to put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Just a little reasoning here from the Lord. Just a little wisdom from above. Don't even take a thought. Take no thought. Whoa. Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? We're better than a sparrow. I hope that's not news to you. Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to his stature? And why take you thought for raiment? In other words, if you can't make yourself taller, why are you even thinking about what you're going to put on? I mean, after all, think about this. God commanded us to dress modestly. Do you think he's not going to dress you? He made you, this flesh, to require food. Do you think he's not going to food? If he makes the rain fall on the just and the unjust, is he unrighteous? Then why are you not resting in him? Look at Isaiah. Isaiah 55. Why do you labor for that which is not bread? And for that which satisfieth not. Why do you labor for that which satisfieth not? Why do you spend money for that which is not bread? Why? The judgments of God. We want them. Trust me. His judgments will set you in the right way and give you his goodness. He'll separate you. He'll separate your mind from serving sin and the devil and the world system, and let him provide for you. That is the kingdom of God. It is only possible. The Old Testament didn't preach the kingdom of God. Only after the Holy Ghost was given can you have the kingdom of God. Why? Because it's the righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, and he wasn't given until Pentecost. 50 days after the Passover was killed, Pentecost. It was 7 Sabbaths in a day. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, how they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If God is clothing the grass of the field in that manner, which is today and tomorrow is cast into the oven, it's only here for a blink. And yet he clothes the grass of the field with the lily of the valley. Shall he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? You that's out there earning a wage so that you can be clothed. Therefore take no thought, saying anything against God. What shall we eat? What shall we drink? Wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things that the Gentile seeks, for your heavenly Father knows that ye have need of these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. That is where you're supposed to be laboring. Take therefore no thought for the morrow. What was it? Casting down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into the obedience of Christ. Why? Because it starts with a thought. What am I going to eat? It takes a thought. What am I going to put on? Where's my shelter? Your Father in heaven knows about this. Take no thought for tomorrow. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Take up your cross daily and put all those thoughts on that cross. He hath given meat unto them that fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. He hath showed his people the power of his works, that he may give them the heritage of the heathen. The works of his hands are verity and judgment, and all his commandments are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. But yet, by the time he came back after 400 years of silence, they didn't know him. They were waiting for him. They talked about him. They talked about him all the time. And he showed up. And they esteemed him not. And his own received him not. Why? Because they did not understand his judgments. Had they understood the fear of the Lord and then understood his judgments, they would have known Christ, because he came full of his judgments. When Jesus sat there and said, there's no thing that can go within a man that can defile him. There were 30,000 things that the man could swallow and be defiled. They said, you're trying to destroy Moses. He says, no, I'm keeping the law, but I'm preaching the kingdom of God. The judgments of God. Because if you're going to live with the Holy Ghost, you're going to have to know about him. People in Isaiah 32, the work of righteousness is quietness. The effect of righteousness is, well, Lord, quietness and assurance. Oh, the work of righteousness is peace. I got that wrong. The work of righteousness is peace. What is it? What is the kingdom of God? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Man, joy that you're set free from the world system, that your Father's providing everything that the world is out there killing themselves to go get. Plus, he gives you safety. He sent redemption unto his people. He hath commanded his covenant forever. Holy and reverent is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do his commandments. His praise endureth forever. That do his commandments. That don't talk about them. They do them. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Up here, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Now it's the beginning of knowledge. Look at it again. But the fools despise wisdom and instruction. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. You want an understanding? Understand. Go back into the Old Testament and look at the holiness of God. How no man was able to come unto him. You get too close, you even get on the mountain, kill him. You're not clean. And I am a holy God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy is understanding. For by me thy days shall be multiplied, and the years of thy life shall be increased. By him. Not because you plan well. No. Not because, it's because safety comes from the Lord. Because he blesses the work of your hands. Not so that your wages are what you live by. We live from our giving. God's judgments are the exact opposite of the world. He said, go to work so that you can eat. But you're not going to eat because you go to work. You're going to eat because I feed you. See? Doing his commandments. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge him speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? When Jesus came, they were looking for the governor. They were looking for the one who was going to destroy the Roman occupation. They were looking for the one upon whose shoulders the government was going to be forever, who was going to come down and rid them of a Roman occupation with power and thunder. Because they knew about Moses. Whew, man, when he comes down, that whole mountain melted. Moses would have melted. Moses had come out of the presence of God shining like a star and didn't even know it. They were looking for that Christ. Well, God had already showed up in a burning bush. So then he came down and lit the mountain on fire. They were looking for that. And they missed the love of God, the greatest commandment, the Savior. Oh, your Savior's here. Who did God bring that message to? Wasn't kings and queens. Wasn't the head of the church. Shepherds. Those men that sat out there at night and looked at the glory of God night after night, looking up into the heavens. All of a sudden the heavens were opened. They saw the angels singing and a declaration. Be of good cheer, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, and he shall be to all people. Thank you, Father. See? Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? Is anybody going to be doing it? Or is everybody going to be holding hands looking for the communal blessing? Well, if we all get together and hold hands while we pray, surely that'll get us up there. No, doing his commandments. Why is it that you're all together holding hands, hoping that this is going to somehow give you admittance? Because there's no judgment. Because the word of God is not pure anymore. That's how come you didn't keep the commandment. That's how come now you get an expression through song as opposed to word. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. There is no rapture coming, but the day of Christ is coming. But everybody's trying to prepare for a rapture. That's why they're building up the stockpile so they can go through the Jacob's trouble. That's foolishness. Take no thought. There's no saving command like he gave to Noah of build an ark to perform for his safety of his life. Noah moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of himself and his house. We have no such command. The things that's coming shall destroy all flesh. The day of Christ is going to destroy all flesh. You're not going to go through it. Ours is going to get changed, and the world's is going to be condemned. There's no preparation that you can have so that you're going to go through it. It's not going to work like that. You can't keep yourself safe. He sends his angels to the four corners of the earth to reap his harvest. What are you going to... Well, how can you prepare yourself for that? Fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The knowledge of the holy is understanding. So be ye holy, for I am holy. See? This is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. We let Him set us free. We don't set ourselves free. I'm done with Him. Well, I'm not. If I'm not, you're not. She just doesn't get it. It's because you didn't tell her the right way. God, a loving, kind God. This is the love of God. We keep His commandments. His commandments are not grievous. Jesus got the grievous commandment, folks. You being around someone filled with devils isn't, what's that to you? Cast them out. Throw them out. Jesus came down and had to let the people filled with devils crucify Him. That was a grievous command. He could call 12 legions of angels, but He didn't. And had He, I wouldn't be talking to you today. He got the grievous command. He became sin that I might become the righteousness. He got my iniquity. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. Your own way. The Lord laid on Him the iniquity of us all. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. Who's that written to? It was written to the church of God, to God's kids. The Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. That's iniquity when you have your own way. What was it Jesus was praying and sweating great drops of sweat as blood? He wasn't wrestling demons. He commanded them. It wasn't his own flesh. From the time he was 12, his flesh, he had that down. But he brought himself under to say, not my will, thine be done. Read Isaiah 20, or Psalms 22, and it says, you can look and stare and see my bones, my weak, my there's no fatness in my flesh through fasting. He fasted over his flesh that he would not have his will. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. Jesus knelt down and said, not my will, thine be done. And it was sweating great drops of blood. He was up early, often, long before daylight. He was up all night long. Not my will, thine be done. Take your cross daily. You put that flesh out, your flesh on that cross daily. Not my will, thine be done. The Lord's Prayer, daily. Give us this day our daily bread. Are you not supposed to pray for your bread on a daily basis? Yes. It's take no thought for the morrow. Because you took no thought, you made no provision. So when you wake up in the morning, put your flesh on that cross, you take up the cross and you say, our Father, me and Jesus' Father. Oh, what a privilege. Give us this day our daily bread. Daily, day by day. Sufficient unto the day is evil thereof. There's no rapture. But a day of Christ. No saving command like he gave to Noah. Oh, build an ark. Why? Well, because in 120 years from now, we're not even supposed to take thought for tomorrow. By the thing coming, every soul's body shall either be changed or destroyed. Exactly what can you prepare for the tribulation? It's ridiculous, according to Scripture. And yet people are. We are moved by the fear of the Lord to watch and pray, preparing every soul to meet his Lord. He showed his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. This is important. You're one of the two. You're either Jacob or you are Israel. Who are you? He hath not dealt so with any nation, and as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord. Yet all these people praising God, they don't know his judgments. Praise God, they don't know his judgments. And they missed him when he came. Read Isaiah 5. It should make a cold sweat break out on you. The people who were looking for the Lord, the people who said, oh, let him come. Oh, we're looking for you to come. And God said, look, I didn't come because when I come, if I came now, I would enlarge hell to receive you because you don't know me. That was his people, and that's the church today. They can't decipher. They're reading a book called the NIV that one of the editors was one of the editors of Beavis and Butthead. He did the revisions. Why? Why can you not see that? Because there's no spirit. They kicked the Holy Ghost out of those books. You're only going to see the Holy Ghost in the King James Bible. That's it. If you're English. As for his judgments, they have not known them. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not. So you're born Jacob. If you have allowed this word to form you into Israel. Now let's go back up here and look at this again. It'll make more sense. He showed his word to Jacob. He shows his word to the entire world. To the natural man. You see the word. His statutes and his judgments unto Israel. After he forms you. How is it that they had no judgment? That they did not know. They have not known them. We have a church today that doesn't know them. They think that they preach against sin. No, God just said you're all sinners. Now get past it. You're all wrong. Every one of you are wrong. What are you going to do with my love? That's the issue of eternity. You're not supposed to be out there in the world system. You're supposed to go to work so you have to give so that you can have your living from your giving. That's the Lord. You're supposed to be resting. Daily performing your commandments. Taking no thought. You got your thoughts under control. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, thou shalt not be burned. Neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. Pretty well covers about everything, don't you think? Okay, so how are you going to prepare that the flame does not kindle upon you. Well, be redeemed. See? How are you going to prepare that when you walk through the waters, they're not going to overflow you? What makes you think you can prepare yourself for the great tribulation? As if, in a physical sense, there's something that you can do. No, you can understand His judgments. But to understand His judgments, you will be the redeemed. You're not going to have anything because you hold hands with your neighbor and pray. You want to hold hands. But you cannot do without the obedience of God from your heart, by yourself, in your faith, because you heard the word of God, and it saved you. There is no communal blessing. Jesus went through Capernaum, and He took them one by one. Let's come up to the front. Let's all hold hands. Oh, I love God, people. Hey. I have a word. It is pure. And it came from the Lord. It's not that a bunch of people can't get blessed all at once, but it's going to be because you and your heart is in the presence of the Ancient of Days, as if no one is around you. That you're the only person on earth, but He redeemed you. Sin's not the issue for your eternity, but love is the issue for your eternity. Listen to this closely. Now we beseech you, brethren. In other words, they're begging you, brethren. Brethren, I'm begging you. They walk up. Just imagine me walking up to you, and I get down on my hands and knees, and I wrap my arms around your legs. And I say, listen. I'm begging you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, by our gathering together unto Him, I still got you by the legs and I'm holding them, that you be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled. Don't be troubled. Not by spirit or word or by letter as from us. This is the apostles. Is that the day of Christ is at hand? Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself against all above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Paul's writing this to the church. The day of Christ is not at hand. The day of Christ is at hand now. We have listened to what our Lord has told us. The disciples asked Jesus three things. What's the sign? When's the end? How are we going to know? I said that wrong. Anyway, it's Matthew, the beginning of Matthew 24. They ask the Lord three things. He answers, and when is the end going to be? Yeah, when is the end? When are these things going to come to pass? Well, I forget now. Anyway, Matthew 24, it's in the first three or four verses. And he answers those things. We couple that together. But people said that, oh, never mind. Paul is talking here, and he's talking to the church, and he goes, look, the day of Christ is not going to come unless these things take place. Now, all of these have not yet taken place. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed, be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Why are they perishing? Look at this. Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. For this cause, what cause? That they're sinners? No. Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, they should believe a lie, that they might all be damned who are sinners. Oops, doesn't say that. Who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. We're all sinners. We're all wrong. Some are redeemed and some are not. But sin is not the issue. What have you done with the love of God? Because they receive not the love of the truth, God shall send them strong delusion, that they all might be damned. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation. How was it that the children of Israel had a knowledge of salvation? It was by the teaching of the repentance of John the Baptist. That gave them knowledge of salvation, repentance. Why is it that we are to repent and get baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost? Because God was preaching the kingdom of God. He wanted you to have the righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Well, you got to get the Holy Ghost. So how do you get the Holy Ghost? You repent. Prepares the way for salvation. Repent. And get baptized in Jesus' name. Why Jesus' name? Because he's the Christ. He's the Christ of God. When Jesus looked at him and said, hey, who am I, Peter? The Christ of God. He's the Lord's Christ. He's the Messiah, the one waiting, the one prophesied, the one, the seed of Abraham. The one of the promised one. Jesus. If his name was Jorge, we'd all be baptized in Jorge. Or Marcos, or Victoria, or whatever. His name is Jesus. So you're baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. He's going to come. Boy, when he does. But God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation. How? Through sanctification of the Spirit. Immediately when you call upon the name of the Lord, he said to them that received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Didn't say you are because you believed or you received Christ, but I'm going to give you power to become. How? Through the sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. He's going to guide you in. You got to continue in my word. He said, continue. You must be baptized into the name of the Christ. Whereunto he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. What does it say in Galatians 3? That you are baptized into Christ and you put on Christ. Didn't say Jesus. That when you get baptized in Jesus' name, you're getting baptized into the Christ and you're putting on Christ. What is Christ? That's that Holy Ghost. Power over your own way. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or by our epistle. Praise ye, Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises unto my God while I have any being. Put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. And yet people are making alliances, and they're getting prepared for the great Holocaust or whatever's next coming. Well, God said, take no thought. What? You got to be a doer of his commandment. Look, people, three times a year, every man in Israel had to lay down his swords and take off into wherever it was that God called them. Had to leave the country. Wherever his name was, that's where they went. Three times a year. That means there was no watchman left in the land. There was no watchman because all the watchmen had to go. There's no army. The whole army had to go. There was no priesthood. All priesthood had to go. Every male had to go and appear before God three times in the year. But what was God's promise to him? And while you're here worshiping me, nobody's going to want your land. They're not even. It's not that they're not going to get it. He said, no one will want your land. That's God, people. So while you are preparing for the end of the world, we are saying, not my will, thine be done. That's the preparation. Put not your trust in princes. They're in the Son of Man in whom there is no help. They're all going to be consumed. The day of Christ is coming. We're not preparing for a flood. Or I'd say build a boat. Well, God would say, better build a boat. I'm going to flood you. There's nothing coming this time that you can be prepared for. The end is coming. How are you going to prepare? You're going to humble your heart daily. Take your cross daily. Pray for your Father, your Redeemer. Daily. Live in the kingdom of God, in the righteousness, peace, and joy. His breath goes forth. Who? The man that's trying to give you counsel. Yeah, get ready.
Better be ready.
By a bunch of bullets. His breath goeth forth. He returns to this earth. In that very day, his thoughts perished. Why is everyone sitting around taking counsel one of another or from some expert in safety and everything else? Safety cometh from above, from the Lord. Or you're not safe. You simply think you are. Open your news. Take a look on the internet news. Man, it's just filled with things that happen. Kids who stray for a moment. They're going to take a night or a day or a date or a word. And all of a sudden, they're no more. Life's destroyed. Family's wrecked. Why? Because safety's of the Lord. You want to put safety in your own hands? You will reap what you sow. Happy is he that hath a God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God, which made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that therein is, which keepeth truth forever. Remember, he's going to be mindful of his covenant. My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing gone out of my mouth. God bless you, brother. Which executeth judgment for the oppressed, which giveth food to the hungry. The Lord loose the prisoners. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. Where are you going to go to get your blind pill? Are you blind? Where are you going to go and take a pill so you don't be blind? How are you going to prepare for that? The Lord raises them that are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord preserves the strangers. Look, people, this is the word of God. Where's your faith? When the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? Noah believed God. When he said, build a boat, he did. It was accounted for righteousness. How is it that you're going to be accounted for righteousness? Take no thought. You got a stockpile? Dump it. Give it away. Your faith is going to prove you before your Father. Your faith. Can you break His commandments and start taking thought and still love Him at His appearing? Or are you going to be ashamed at His coming? Are you going to love Him at His appearing or be ashamed at His coming? I told you I was coming. I told you don't keep all this stuff laying around. Man, look at how your neighbors, they were all hungry. Look at all that. See? The Lord opened the eyes of the blind. The Lord hath raised them that are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord loves the righteous. The only righteousness you get comes from Jesus. The first five letters, right. The only way that man is ever right. He became sin that we might become the right. From God. Had nothing to do with you. Had nothing to do with your dad, your mom. Had nothing to do except with the Savior. The Lord preserves the strangers. He relieves fatherless and widow. But the way of the wicked He turns upside down. The Lord shall reign forever. Even thy God, O Zion, unto all generations. Praise ye, Lord. Praise ye, Lord. For it is good to sing praises unto our God. For it is pleasant and praise is comely. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathers together the outcasts of Israel. The outcasts. Why were they out there? Because they outcast Jesus. He came in, He sat down in a chair, and He goes, this day is this fulfilled in your ears. Later that same afternoon, while they were in the synagogue, they tried to march Him off of a hill so He would die. This is how the Messiah was taken. They took Him without the camp and they crucified Him without the camp. Why? Because He's the outcast. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcasts of Israel. He heals the broken in heart and binds their wound. He tells the number of the stars. He calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite. The Lord lifts up the meek. He casts the wicked down to the ground. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving. Sing praise upon the harp unto our God, who covers the heaven with clouds, who prepares rain for the earth, who makes grass to grow upon the mountains. He gives to the beast his food, to the young ravens which cry. He delights not in the strength of the horse. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. The Lord takes pleasure in them that fear Him, in those that hope in His mercy. Praise ye, Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in the firmament of His power. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him upon the psaltery and harp. Praise Him with the timbrel and dance. Praise Him with the stringed instruments and organs. Praise Him upon the loud cymbals. Praise Him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. God is good. He relieves you from having to build bigger barns, fill them up for who knows who's coming afterwards. He could have said, okay, build a big barn and fill it full. And you're going to give it to so-and-so. Otherwise, no heaven for you. And He did just the opposite. He goes, look at the grass. It's clothed with a lily of the valley. Solomon wasn't arrayed like that. He had gold from around this world. He wasn't arrayed like that little grass. Mm-mm. Will He not clothe you? seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things be added unto you. When the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? Are you going to be here taking no thought for tomorrow? Are you just going to be praising him today? Give us this day our daily bread. Keep us from temptation. Deliver us not into evil. Grace to you.